What's good, YouTube? And welcome to the house. By far the most asked question of me lately is, John, what cheap card should I be going after in Dual Overload? There's so many things under a dollar, and I want to know what I should be getting now, what I should be setting aside, what I should be keeping that could go up in price. I'm going to give several forewarnings here before telling you guys to use my TCG player link in the description down below, costing you nothing extra and supporting the channel directly for the cards you'd already be buying that are super cheap right now. First off, Dual Overload will be having an unlimited printing somewhere down the road if history repeats itself. Kaiba Collection got an unlimited printing. We also had Dual Power, the other March 100 card set, get an unlimited printing. Dual Overload will highly likely have that unlimited printing, and whatever quantities you're setting aside over time, you must truly believe in them that they'll be going up, because otherwise, guess what? Quantities are going to flood the market later of this card and then slowly go off. So the second part of this is bankroll management. You've got to make sure your money is good to set these aside and not panic at some point, that you actually have enough money for when you're heading towards Eternity Code cards and other such cards. While these are cheap, that's why people can't go after everything all at once and just have stacks of hundreds of each card. That's why vendors only get to play the game of 2 to 3 of these. Whatever they believe most of in the set, they typically only take 2 to 3 picks, and then everything else must go. They've got to pay employees, they've got to pay overhead. For you guys, you've got to look forward to the next set, the next thing, and that money could be actually flipping itself in that time. So whatever margins you're getting, you have to weigh that against, well, I could have made trades with this card, and I could have traded up time and time again. So if you're going for long-term keeps, definitely think about that. That being said, the first cards that are eyebrow raisers to me are the Speedroid Engine. I wouldn't be going after a ton of these. I would just have my play sets, because I've been taught to never, ever underestimate this engine. Korean people have shown me what it can do, and it's just crazy to me that I really like these cards. I would never leave them behind, and I would just want access to them. When I look at two more cards on this bottom page, there's eyebrow raisers. Fuma and also Phantasm Emperor Trilogy. For Fuma, people were thinking it's completely random it ended up in the set. No, it's not. Konami went after Spirit Warriors in this set. We also saw the Magical Muskets end up in here. I think Six Samurai have a lot of upward potential. It's not a question of if, but when it becomes very well playable again. And I would definitely have my copies of this at freaking 8 cents versus the $7 they were demanding before. Also, this Emperor, I think, will undoubtedly go up over time. Even if it is printed as a common in this Sacred Beast structure deck, which, why would they release it here if it's going to be? Its holographic form will do well over time. Look at the Ultra Armatile and the other Sacred Beast stuff. This is going to be highest rarity for this card, even if it's reprinted. I would think having your copy set aside is pretty good money on this card. Now, when we go to page 4, we head towards the bottom. Nothing stands out too much to me on this page until I get to the Abyss Actor Link Monster. I see a lot of people trying this on Dueling Book, and I do think it's a very good card. Same with the Melodious card, but that's a lot more specific. I think the Abyss Actor Link is a bit interesting, and I would want to have my copies of this. Now, going through this page, Chaos Goddess. People have been asking, people love collecting waifus. Will these eventually get slurped off market? Possibly, but do you really see this above a dollar? Maybe even above the 50 cent mark? There's going to be so many of these, and it's not necessarily going to see immense play. I know it's one of Cap G's favorites, by the way, but I just don't see this as one of the best long-term investments. But the waifu tax has surprised us more than a few times, so while my take on it is a no, you might make money if your take is a yes. I love Gigaplanth as a card in general. Having a holo foil form for past formats is pretty cool. Also, White Mare appears on this page. To White Mare, I say this is horrendously undervalued and will eventually be $3 solid in my opinion. Every single version of holographic Skull Servant stuff has gone up over time, and you see this here. Yugi's World is a very different case when we're talking about legendary duelists, legendary collections, all that kind of stuff. The legendary collections of past were massive sets, and you were so much less likely to get certain cards. But you see, even the vanilla Skull Servant Holo up there. We have the Speed Duels King of the Skull Servant up there. people love the school servants in general. That's why I would call this to be $3 in the future, and this is something I would hoard as many copies of as I could. Now, will your sales rates be amazing when you finally decide to cash in? I think it'll take time. You might look like this waiting for them to all sell, but I do think it will become a $3 to $5 solid card. Very much so, I'm conservative calling three, much so like the other Skull Servant cards. I think this is one of the best lower investments in the set by far for overtime, but you're not going to make money anytime fast off that card. Zephyros is something I've gone back and forth on. I think Zephyros overall is a pretty cool card. In fact, I think I have a tab of him open. Yeah, so this is its second holo foil printing versus its old, you know, duels pack crow holo, and then everything else will probably end up under this, including, well, star foils are easy to make disappear. I just think that it's almost going to be treated as the common for a while when we come to Zephyros, because it's going to be so readily available. Out of all the estimated value pulled of this set, it's not one of the best forward cards, but it's ended up in multiple metagames, and you still have the Lunalight deck running around, which people think may get hit, may not get hit. I do like the card long term, but I also, if I'm making my own personal money decisions as a store, it's not something I'd go into, or managing my own bankroll, it's one that I would be passing on versus all the other penny stocks. Speaking of number hunters, number 27, Dreadnought Dreadnoid got its reprint here. It was only expensive originally, not for gameplay, but because it was shorted. I think this will eventually be a dollar solid, but weigh that versus the 22 cents that people are paying. I think a lot of the Link monsters being original to this set have potential to go up, but so I'm not going to concentrate on Link monsters right now too much, besides a few of my very best picks, but do consider what Links you do think will have success in the game. The Magical Muskets fell out very quick. I just have these to play with, not to invest in. I would just have my playset secure for the deck. I think it's a fun rogue deck. I love how it works, but from an investment standpoint, it's kind of turning into bulk of the set. Vanity's Ruler, also a card that has popped up a couple times in Yu-Gi-Oh's history, but not really ever dominated the meta. We have Infinite Impermanence. We have other cards that help get past this now. I wouldn't put too much faith in this card, but it's something nice to have set aside because those Mausoleum decks always do pop up here and there and get some hype. So it's kind of one that I'd peek at, but I don't think I'd sink my money into personally. I would be putting my money definitely towards Last Warrior from Another Planet. Waking the Dragon target, John? It's not just that. It's, well, you're seeing into the future of some of my other picks. It's towards GOAT format, and look at every copy of Gatling Dragon, despite it having far more copies than Last Warrior. Look at this. Even the lowest version, the common from a legendary collection, and I know it's Joey's World, we just discussed how those things are harder to get, but wow. Wow, towards $3, $4 for the cheapest version of this GOAT format fusion. Now, GOAT format has fallen a bit in popularity, but we have one as recent as OTS7 getting its own waves of buyouts towards $7 for another version of a common. Now, there's tons of quantities of this floating around. It is versus other estimated value pulled from the set, but long term, this is a keeper by far, and people are just going to want copies of it for Waking the Dragon, for GOAT format, for multi-purposes. That's why it's already not bulk right now, and it's towards 50 cents, but I do think this will be a solid 3, kind of similar to Gatling Dragon, towards the future. It really depends if Konami continues to slam this as stuff like commons and OTS packs on its long-term value, but I think even if they keep doing that, you could see it be $3 for this ultra printing. I'm not the biggest fan of Compulse. In terms of its current gameplay, it's popped up into recent Yu-Gi-Oh! History a few times. I don't like how it looks too much as an ultra rare. You also have the secret rare available, kind of similar to MST, which I'm dodging around right now. Dodge. But I think that Compulse, it could be good, but it's one of those ones I pick to stay away from, but I understand if you pick it, why you're liking it. Now, let's go back towards that MST I accidentally put early. My tabs are kind of far open, so it's hard to tell what I'm clicking on. So many versions of holographic MST exist. Why is this so much better than bulk? Those 11 cent bulks, why is this 50 cents in the set? Well, it's hard to get a nice looking version, and even the bad versions of this tend to head towards $2. Like, that's just what happens here. Look, you can't even get the gold rare towards that. The platinum rare, people despise this rarity. I think it looks kind of funny on this card. Oh, wow, it's over $2. So every holographic version of this tends to go up over time. Past format decks are a huge thing, especially with MSC and how prevalent it was. People are going to want a ton of copies of these. It's not just going to sink down in price, if anything. I think this ultra rare eventually heads towards $2. It would be one of my keeps in terms of, I'd want maybe a stack of 30 of these for my own past format decks, if not even more, because it's a nice looking alternative version. And you might look at some of these prices like, oh, look, Spell Ruler is so low. Oh, no, it's not. You're going to be looking at your cheapest copies towards $7. So I really like MST as a pick to go up over time, and it's where I would personally be sinking my money long term, because no matter how many holo versions of this pops up, it seems like it stays really stable and well placed. Digusto Emerald, out of all these cards, is great for multiple past formats, could cycle back into current formats. I like this card. Synchro looping decks tend to like to make this as well, and he even has like bigger loops than that, so do consider Digusto Emerald while he's under $1. Golden Castle has a lot of potential as an engine in general. I wouldn't sleep on this either, but again, you can only go so many places with your money, right? You got to make your strongest picks. And Awakening of the Possessed, I pointed out there is future support for Charmers. They're getting their own structure deck in the OCG. I think it might translate over here. We'll have to see what Konami USA has with Crush Card and all the product delays that are happening in the EU and what structure decks they do want to bring in. We skipped the Warrior structure deck, but I like this card as a long-term investment call because of how popular the Charmers are, and that there would be my pick for the waifu tax in this set. We get towards the second page, we're getting out of the penny stonks and more towards the dollar range, but that's still pretty good pricing overall for long-term investments in your calls. Magellan, under $1, is very nice. People will be taking playsets of these off of the market at a time, and you see a lot of the lowest sellers now do not offer playsets at a time. You kind of have to shop and get multiple cards from them to get them at a cheaper price. I think this will be towards $2 over time, similar to the Necroz stuff. I do like the Phantom Beast Link at under $1, but this is about where I thought it would pop up. Almirage has an insanely high sales rate, yet can't seem to get up there in price. If the sales rates continue, you could see that baby bump up back towards $1, $2. But man, I'm really shocked at its low price now, and I'd be a customer of this card at this price. Swap Frog Holographic. Oh, it looks so good. I've seen it on camera. It looks so freaking good. But right next to him, I'm seeing this played immediately. So much on Dueling Book right now. My player brain says this is a $5 card that's getting overlooked in this set. But you try not to invest with your player brain too much. I just think, personally, highly undervalued. Get your some Morglink. For Swap Frog, I think he's about evaluated correctly. Maybe he floats up towards $2 over times $3 like the other Holo Frog stuff, but you have a higher rarity. Mid rarities can be popular though, and you could see a $3 version of this like in the future after the unlimited print and them running off the market. Omega's way underestimated here. We look at the past versions of Omega, and the Battles of Legend one, you almost got one in every single box. While there's a ton of quantities of the Dual Overload version running here, I think it'll be $3 solid over time. Like, there's just no way. And the secrets do look a bit nicer, so they'll appreciate more first, and there are a ton of quantities of the Battles of Legend, even from years ago. Don't sleep on this card. Get yours sooner than later. Don't let this one slip through your fingers. Even if it's just your one for yourself, get your copy. Now, we start to get towards the higher cards, like why Strix fell out. You want, as I've been corrected, multiple copies of Medulce Pudding Cess Chocolate All Mode for the deck, so she's a little bit stronger of an investment than I would have thought. I still like getting these cards earlier than later, because you are going to see sellers run out of their quantities. You're going to see the kind of fallout from the set, the maximum amount of sellers, about a week and a half out from release. A lot of the prices are cheapest now. That's why people are wondering what they should clamor towards. These are the last two cards I really like from this page. Besides the Sky Striker Link, it's about where I evaluated it though. It is a fair price, which means if it's like this on the market, wow, a lot of people are calling for it to go up. So people might be holding quantities rather than listing it. And then we're finally out of the penny stocks. We can talk about the fallout of the set after we get past everything that's $2. I think the Xyz link is a pretty good call. The artifact link is underestimated even at this price. I would not pick up any of these giant cards. Vendors are just like, please take these, please take these. But if you want to make a wall full of these or something, you really like how they look, I don't blame you. They're super affordable if you're going after them. But man, I would stay away. Alter Art Tour Guide, people are telling me I underestimate her on the market. And I don't disagree. It's just not what I would be jumping out of this set if I'm spending my money. I'd be jumping after things like White Mare that I feel are far more underestimated. Could this be $5? Let me know what you think. If this will be $5 over time, if the Alter Art stuff will pay off that well and get that hype, or if it's going to stick around 3 for a much longer time. I'm still calling for 3 because there's so many other cards like Dengirsu right now and Lib that have the chance that were just overlooked at the beginning of this to really, really spike. You have the plant stuff coming soon. I feel like Rosebell is overestimated, but I do understand why people are leaning towards it. Still a really great generic card for plants, but the other alters like Infinity, you're about to see this played in ABC. You're about to see this go other places. Now we head towards 5 and up. You have Emergency actually falling out a little right now. Levineer really sticking. Relinquish Anima actually going up. If I was a vendor, this is what I would be just chunking out the window. Him and Selene. Selene, oh my gosh, it is sticking up there in price. And now other things are falling out. Howl Frybrax, originally from 35 down towards 30. You have Anaconda under $20 as people are slashing each other's prices. And Imperm towards $19. Oh, that is music to my ears under that $20 mark. Also, Phantasme kind of starting to do its float back and forth thing between 13 to 15. And Union Carrier, if you're going big bucks, underestimated, the dark horse of the set, I would have Union Carrier right now before anything else out of the high price stuff in the set. And Mining under $10. This is below my projections of what I thought it would be. I thought it might be 12, 10 solid if it was shorted, which it is. Not enough Cybers fans as we head towards Master Rule 4. But there you have it. This is an entire set breakdown of Dual Overload and my personal calls for penny stocks and what I would be going for and my reasoning behind it. When I approach a set like this, I try to break even and then be a little greedy. And I do try to profit. Like, let's say if I was in the Robbie Cole position of spending 20 grand, I would try to profit 4 grand and then play really greedily with my keeps. Not everybody can afford to do that. You know, if you're going in for the next set, you probably want to go even further into Eternity Code because that's going to be one of the best core sets of all time. There is Crush Card looming at the same time, so I understand why people want the cheap things to hold on to for a while because we're going to be stuck inside for a while. But keep in mind the window, unlimited printing, say it with me, unlimited printing coming sometime soon. Thank you so much for watching through this video. I know these get better watch time than my other videos, but typically there's less people that slam that TCG player link in the description down below, costing them nothing extra and supporting the channel directly when going after these cards because they are cheaper. So please be sure to use that link for me if you are shopping. It helps a ton, and I want to keep bringing content, not necessarily with the motivation to make myself more, but to continue to educate you guys and help you make your decisions on what you're going towards the bottom portions of the set, the bargain basement, as it were. But please subscribe, and thanks for watching, everybody. See you on the live stream later tonight, 7 o'clock Central, if you're gonna make it for Sunday night, if you're watching this, you know, Sunday when I uploaded it.